Hello, let's look at Robyn versus FastAPI. Robyn is growing very quickly, and this is the GitHub page. It does the same thing as FastAPI for what I used it for. I'm not saying all the features are the same, but if you look at the example code from Robyn, import Robyn, app equals Robyn, app.get, async def, function name, request. So this is the performance, and let me just get that in place. Plain text responses per second. So the fastest one is Robin. So that's 600,000 responses per second. We look at Uvicorn, 400,000. Look at FastAPI itself, it's down at about 180,000. FastAPI hyphen Uvicorn, similar. So I didn't pick it deliberately because of speed, but I became aware of the speed difference once I started reading about it. What first attracted me to super fast async Python web framework with a Rust runtime was partly I've got some knowledge of Rust now, but in addition, just the documentation made it very easy to get started. So meet Robyn, fast, innovative, friendly, and community-driven Python web framework. Robyn merges Python's async capabilities with a Rust runtime, and that is part of the reason why it's very fast. I know Rust is quite controversial; it's got a bit of a learning curve. But to be honest, that's just what it's written in. It doesn't mean that the Python API is any different. So, as we just saw, from Robyn, import Robyn. App equals Robin, so you're instantiating a class of Robin. App.get, got the wrapper or decorate. Async def, then as we just saw, app.start. So you don't have to specify Uvicorn or Gunicorn or anything there. And in the past, I've made a project where I was using Uvicorn, and I really I You always get the do not use this in production warnings and so on. So this is my code. This is what I did. So I'll show you the actual site in a second. But this is calling a piece of code which I've researched, you learned, copied, whatever. I've built a collection in Quadrant, which is a vector database. That's not entirely relevant to this, other than the fact that that's what this particular piece of code is doing. You could be querying your own database, pulling some results from a JSON file, plain text file, whatever. This just happens to be what I'm doing here, these lines 4 and 5. So, and that's just me importing my own function or my own class. So, to actually use it. It's all here. So I did a Robin Hello World endpoint because I published this through Nginx on a Linux VPS. So here we've got app.get and then we've got API forward slash search. I probably should have done V1 there. I should version the API, but I haven't done yet. Async def search startup, and then I'm passing in a request where the request is Q for query and then equals and then whatever the query is. So Q equals request.query.params.get. So this is fairly standard syntax, really. There's no massively steep learning curve. Let's just go back to the Robin documentation. One of the great things is the just find it the Batman example. You'll know what I mean when I say Batman. It's obviously a pun with the word Robin, but let's just see, getting started. So it's got other authentication, middlewares, log monitoring, deployment. So I can't remember if it supports Swagger yet. I think I read that it doesn't. That might be one drawback if you're using this in production in your workplace. I don't think it supports Swagger just yet. I might be wrong. Oh yeah, out of the box. It's coming soon. Yeah. Had to find out about that. So Yep. Create a virtual environment. Batman create a virtual environment. Install Robyn using pip. Pip install Robyn. So you've got a nice menu when you start. It asks you if you want to use a database. You can just say no or pick whatever one from that list. So you get a source directory, and then you've got an app.py, and it creates you a Docker file as well. You don't have to use anything to do a Docker, don't worry. This example uses SQL Alchemy, which personally I don't ever use. And this, I guess it does slightly steer you down a certain road with that, but don't worry. I mean, this is very similar to what you would have in with Pydantic in FastAPI. It's creating some types. Setting up the application. So this is all doing the CRUD. So you're creating the functions that you will use with your endpoints. So the endpoints, app dot, you got post, you got get, you got all the usual authentication. Decided to use JWT, JSON Web Token. So you add the auth, where is it? So get the password. Hash password equals get password hash user dot password. And then you're just passing in the hash password. It's okay, you proceed. If it's not okay, then you don't get in. Oh, you need to use bearer token as well. Yeah, so I don't want to really go there. If you want to learn about using JWT, I've done a recent tutorial on my website about using JWT with serial DB. I tried to make it as easy as possible. So some Rust code here that creates a JWT. Just doing it there. With serial DB, it's quite easy. You just sign up and you pass in these parameters, and then it creates you a token. You use JWT as its secure token. And then when you come to use it, this is the Python code here, which just one line really. DB dot authentication token. Then I've got my token there, but obviously you'd hide that in a .env file or somewhere. If that works, prints authentication successful and your code carries on. If it doesn't, the rest of your code won't run. So yeah, that's the JWT side of things. I shouldn't worry too much about the JWT. Not if you just want to just test out Robyn. So why did I use it? I used it with, let me show you. Got semantic search. I think I used it on this one. So here, whatever I search for, we'll call that neural searcher. So error, let's just search aeroplane engineer. And it's going to do semantic search across a lot of YouTube videos. If you design the plane with the wing swept up like this, when it turns, you know what happens? This wing loses lift, gets more lift, blah, blah, blah. He's talking about airplane engineering. He's talking about Boeing 737. So, no, there's no mention of airplane there. You've got aeronautical engineering, you've got Boeing 737. So, yeah, semantic search. That's using quadrant, by the way. So, when I click search, that is actually calling get. Just zoom in a bit more here. There you go. It's just doing a get request. Now, I know it should be post if you're sending any secure data or anything, and yeah, this is kind of just initial proof of concept, a minimum viable product, I would say. And then you get the result back in JSON. Why is it coming back in JSON? Because the result is the result, and the result is coming back as JSON from my neural searcher.search. If you want to see the code for that, just quickly cover that. I know I'm kind of going around the houses a bit, but search result, query points, payloads. It's returning payload, which is a JSON, a Python dictionary, JSON. Hit.payload for hit in search result. Use the vector for search for closest vectors in the collection. So it's a load of key value pairs, and that's why it's coming back. And then the JavaScript is just passing that out. So Robyn, fast. Yeah, so the swag is coming soon. So I would say for production, that might be an issue. It might just be that this hasn't been updated, I don't know. And obviously FastAPI is still great, but if performance is an issue, then you might just want to look at this, because part of the reason I used it was just because I didn't want to feel dirty and use Uvicorn or Gunicorn, because you get all those errors, what you get those warnings about don't use it in production, etc. So I was aware of Robyn, and I remembered that it was fast. So 600,000 versus 400,000, and then so on. You can see all the performance stats there. It's got a lot of stars. It's grown rapidly, 4.2k stars on GitHub. So updated last week. So actively maintained, which is always a good thing. And it's a big enough project now, 70 contributors. So it's not going to go away overnight. And I think it's definitely worth trying. And it's, you know, you could probably do the Batman example and do that in about half an hour. And yeah, it's just another, you know, another tool in your toolbox, so to speak. So yeah, thanks for watching. And I'll be back soon. If you want any more web scraping videos, let me know. I don't know if I can do much on the JavaScript splash side of things. In fact, part of the reason of using the scrape ops API is that it renders a JavaScript for you. So again, depends if you're using this in a commercial environment or just for a project or like a Fiverr gig or something. If you're doing a Fiverr gig, then you need to work out whether you want to be doing Fiverr gigs regularly, and then whether it might actually be cheaper to pay for scrape ops or similar to save your time, because your time is money, isn't it, and all that. So just talking about scrape ops, just a shameless plug there. I'll put a link in the description if you want to try them out. Get 10% discount, use my code. FastAPI, Robyn, my code. If you're interested in how I did the neural searcher, I can do a video on that. It's using the all mini LLM-L6-V2 large language model, which isn't so large. Part of the reason I'm doing all these sort of smaller LLM type based things is because my laptop's quite old, and yeah. And also, I don't want to pay for tokens for OpenAI. So, Quadrant, Robyn, FastAPI, SurrealDB. I know it's been a bit of a magical mystery tour, but yeah, they all kind of fit together, and especially SurrealDB has got such amazing documentation. Some of it is getting developed, so some of the things, like here, when you call the you don't, it uses WebSockets, by the way, so just one thing to bear in mind. So much to learn, so little time, but thanks for watching. I'll be back soon.